heard there was a secret chord that David played and it pleased the Lord. But you don't really care for music, do you? It goes like this: the fourth, the fifth, the minor fall, the major lift, the baffled king composing hallelujah. 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 God above, as for me, all I ever learned from love is how to shoot at someone who outdrew you. But it's not a cry that you hear tonight. It's not some pilgrim who claims to have seen the light. No, it's a cold and it's a very broken hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
Hello everyone, welcome to Bardcast 15. That was of course the great Leonard Cohen from his Live in London concert in 2008. He died in his sleep on November 7th, 2016 at the age of 82 at his home in Los Angeles. In accordance with his wishes, he was laid to rest in a simple pine casket in a family plot at one of the oldest traditional Ashkenazi synagogues in Canada. He was, without doubt, one of the greatest poet, songwriter, performers the world has ever known. One more angel taking a well-earned rest. He would have been appalled by the news that's still barely filtering out of Ethiopia concerning the atrocities that seem to be intimately connected to the codes I've been showing you over the last two podcasts. After almost 5 months of conflict under an almost complete media ban, BBC News finally reported 2 days ago that Ethiopia's Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed has said Eritrea will withdraw its troops from the Tigray region, where human rights groups now estimate thousands have died. Ahmed admitted this week for the first time that Eritrean troops were in the region. Soldiers have been repeatedly accused of gross human rights violations, including the massacre of civilians, systematic rape of women, and looting of public and private property. Hundreds of thousands have fled their homes in Tigray over the last 5 months. BBC News says Prime Minister Abiy Ahmed's announcement of the withdrawal of Eritrean troops comes amid growing international pressure on his government to act over numerous reports of these atrocities. He himself has said simply, any soldier responsible for raping or looting would be held accountable. Maybe the troops pull out might make it easier to conduct an independent investigation into the allegations, but particularly conspicuous by its absence from the BBC article is any mention of the elephant in the room, the possibility that the Ark of the Covenant, whether real or a replica, may have been taken. Nor is there any mention of the bombing of the remote hilltop monastery, Debre Damo, where, other reports have stated, six Eritrean soldiers climbed 80 feet of rope, the only way of access to the plateau of the monastery, killed one monk and looted for manuscripts and treasures. 12 buildings were described as completely destroyed. The BBC says simply that Eritrea has dismissed all accusations of abuses, in particular those detailed in Aksum and at the Church of St. Mary of Zion, as preposterous, fabricated. Well, the news is only just beginning to come out still, and even then it seems to be heavily censored. This is an all too common story, isn't it? Prosperous countries in the world are preoccupied with the things that they've got on their plate and not much interested in what happens to these situations that are history repeating itself over and over. Perhaps the only solace that we can take is from a poet, whether that be Shakespeare or a more modern poet like the great Leonard Cohen. So just listen to these words from another great song of his from that same London concert that puts it into the only perspective that you really can have. I believe this is a song called Anthem. Thank you, Mr. Cohen, for everything you gave us. So let me recap briefly the codes you've seen so far. The Old Testament contains essentially, this contains a lot more, but I'm just recapping for you. It's got the tree of life cross at the top. It's got the tree of knowledge of good and evil. The Rosicrucian cross to show you who's doing this, who's securing this knowledge for future generations, and the ark is crossing it, and right up there at the top is the cross that connects all of that together, the word covenant, the ark of the covenant, and then a fifth cross that says hidden in a church. And the message there was confusing to me as to whether is this a metaphor, or are they actually saying it's still hidden somewhere, and does that matter, and how can we talk about it, because it seems such a confrontational and controversial issue. But as with all of Dee's work, it's all about balancing opposites, and therefore you've got to look, and I did, at the New Testament engraving. And I showed you last broadcast this portion of it that shows you Knights Templar, De Salomoni, the Knights Temple of Solomon, John Dee's signature a couple of times up there on the left-hand side, along with the word lie pointing to Fort Antonia, telling you that this is an integral part of the story, that Solomon's Temple that later became Herod's Temple, that this whole structure here is Fort Antonia. It's not what the Jewish nation believes is the situation where Solomon's temple was, and Herod's. That temple is further south in the city of David, where it can only be because of the Gihon spring, fresh water that was needed at the temple, and for the priests to clean themselves and to wash the blood of the sacrifices away, and all of that. And the archaeologists are doing lots and lots of work now that tell us that is so. Flavius Josephus wrote about it and said it was so. Jesus Christ himself, speaking on the Mount of Olives, said it was so. This would just disappear. Not one stone would be left on another. And yet we look across there from the Mount of Olives and yeah, there's 10,000 stones. So was Jesus wrong? Or is the truth the fact that that is really the remnants of the old Fort Antonia? And here they are telling us, they're telling us that in the King James Bible ciphers. And all of this standing on a firm foundation of the Devir, the Holy of Holies that is in Solomon's temple that contains the Ark. Perfect. A couple of weeks before that, I had shown you this other section that is in that same New Testament grid, because it seems a bit overwhelming. There's so much stuff. On top of that, Devir you have here to the right, you've got two tables. They were called tables in the Bible. We call them tablets, the tablets of stone inside the Ark, the stone of the Ten Commandments, but two sets of them. And then there's two sets of, oh, the testimony, tables of testimony, the Bible says, and then the tables of Moses, two sets, and then the Ten Commandments, broken commandments and the real commandments that are to be kept. A metaphor again about the own. Are there two sets of these tables? Well, the Bible does say so. Moses broke the first set, broke those commandments. Not the commandments he broke. The people were breaking the commandments. He broke the actual tablets. Here you have Kapporet linked to King Menelik's cross, and another Kapporet linked across to the Ark, and another cross linking across to that Ark that says Tabot, which is the Ethiopian word for the Ark of the Covenant, or for the contents of the Ark, or for the gold lid on the Ark, which is called the Mercy Seat, or the Kapporet. All of those together, and finally capped off with all of this through the middle, I, the Messiah. So it's a very strong message that I had shown you, that there was this idea that I had been led to that said, well, you must connect these two together, old and new, but if you just put them on top of each other like this, you're just going to have the same message. It's not going to change anything. They have to be combined in a different way. But it turns out that the 312 characters in the Old Testament, they're referring to Micah 3:12. The 264 characters in the New Testament, referring to the page in the first folio that gives the whole game away and tells you how to decode all the Shakespeare codes. MOAI doth sway my life. You'll find that in other presentations. I won't go into it. But they add those two together, you get 576, and 576 is 24 squared. And so by putting them together this way, by putting them both into now a 24 grid, they place together and you've got an entirely new grid. Is that even possible? Is it even conceivable that this can give you yet more message? Again, and I had shown you last podcast that you look again at the center. And now the center message is the most perfect of all, literally as simple as can be. I dot, I am the et. Et, the particle, the Hebrew particle, which is the Aleph Tav, which means the first letter and the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and which is translated as et, et, the Alpha and the Omega. I am the beginning and the end. It's clear as day. It's the ultimate truth of the Godhead. You bring that down a bit and you see, oh, he's got the word am underneath that. I am the beginning and the end. I am the Alpha Omega. Who is, what is, right underneath it, perfectly balanced, and right on top of it, perfectly balanced, and underneath it again, going one step further into a cross. Et, again, D's favorite way of putting these two together, because he says it's not just the Alpha and the Omega, it's the Omega and the Alpha. Everything has to be perfectly mirror image balanced. Et, and te, as he puts in the gravestone, te, et, backwards. I am the perfect balance of beginning and end, end and beginning. Who am I? King and Savior, Jesus Christ. So that's the central message of combining these two, the Old and the New Testaments. And you would think that that would be sufficient for a central message after you've put these two grids together that reveal so much about crosses and the Ark and the Temple Mount, etc., etc. And yet, right next to it, in a perfect cross again, are these words, Rocio, Madonna. And I introduced you to that last time. Rocio Madonna comes from the work of Timothy Smith's book, The God Code. It's a very good History Channel documentary about it. I highly recommend it. What is the Rocio Madonna? It's a vision of Mary that occurred, and it's probably the earliest of all the Marian visitations. We're all familiar with the Lord's vision, Fatima. There are so many, about 40 are listed as being recognized by the church. But this one is perhaps the oldest of all. It happened around about the 12th century. A hunter goes into a clearing in the woods and sees this vision of Mary, and she is giving birth to the Christ child, and she's quite a fearsome character because it's not just the usual blessing and serene Mary. This is more like the Mary in the in Revelation, the Virgin of the Apocalypse, and in fact she's showing her power, and in her halo around her head it was said that she had images of the Ark of the Covenant and the Holy Grail and on her clothing. And then so this became, eventually they built a chapel there, and today it's a small town in southern Spain where a million people gather every year to celebrate the festival of the Rocio Madonna. Well, what's that doing here? What is that name even doing here? Absolutely perfectly placed as a cross right next to that image. The way they celebrate her, that particular vision, is that it's understood that she was showing that she is actually the Ark. If you think about it in its deepest sense, the Mother of God has in her womb the Word of God, literally. The Ark contains the Word of God. That is a physical representation of it. But this vision is the ultimate. God is inside her. And in the vision that happened, she actually brought out, she gave birth in front of the hunter, and the Christ child man rose to heaven. A very beautiful thought that she is this, she is the Ark. And so, right next to that name again, here's the picture of her that I showed you last time, of the understated Catholic Church in which she resides. Can't help just loving that. Do love their gold. But why not? They're honoring the Divine Mother. So, connected to the Rocio Madonna is the word Ark. And connected to the other side and in a cross that going right down through all of that into the letters that aren't used and crossing the sea of Christ is the word Tabot, which is the Ethiopian word for the Ark and the contents of the Ark. Incredible. This is absolutely, obviously intentional, and there's more there, but I just wanted to recap and show you that. So it's just by putting them into different grids, 12 by 26, 12 by 22, and finally the two of them together, 24 squared, you have this perfection, and there's the other things that are in it that you can look back on Bardcast 14 to see. Well, you know, there's this idea then of connecting the two together. What was going on at that time period when this was being done? 1611 was when the King James Bible was finally published. It had been appointed to happen in 1604. John Dee was absolutely certainly involved, clearly, as was Sir Francis Bacon, and as was, I believe, Edward de Vere. And the message in everything else that John Dee was doing at the time was all about that, about union. Uniting. There was a schism going on in the Christian world with the Catholics and the Protestants, which you'll hear about in a whole other presentation about the Fisher Kings. But at the same time, it turned out there was a similar schism going on in the Judaic tradition. And I was led to then realize, you know, that's one engraving and another engraving. These are not the text of the Bible. This is something that they specifically wrote themselves in the engravings to deliver this message. And yet in the text as well is this Psalm 46, the shake and the spear. And that had revealed a lot of mathematics, if you remember, but there wasn't, that hadn't put it into a grid. And I awoke from a dream then, oh, I guess 3 weeks ago or so, and I realized, oh, you must put that into a grid, but it doesn't fit into a grid itself. And the intuition came, well, you know, it's 46, so I'm going to connect it, or at least I'm going to look at connecting it to Psalm 54, because that makes 100, and that's the divine number squared, just like we had that 24 squared. But there's much more than that in that number 54, as you will see. But by doing that, it seemed to answer a lot of questions about this idea of unifying two separate entities, bringing the Old and the New Testament together, the Judaic tradition and the Christian tradition, the monotheism of Judaism, of "Hear, O Israel, the Lord God is one God," and the Trinity concept in the Christian tradition of the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost all in one. Let me show you what I mean. Here's King David's Psalms, the baffled king, composing a hallelujah. Here's the Psalm 46 that showed you the 46 word from the beginning was shake, and the 46 word from the end was spear. So look back at the earlier Bardcast 12 and 13 to fully understand where this is going. But when you add the Psalm 54, then look what happens. We know in the Judaic traditions there's this absolute central idea of the Sephiroth being not just the word of God, but the whole concept of the divine in 10 emanations. Now, there was a system called Dovrin, Sephirot, which specifically said you would go through these emanations in a certain order, from Keter, the crown, and through all of these going diagonally and horizontally, and you reach the end, and that end is Malkuth, where, having gone on that journey, the idea is that you, the soul, going through all of these emanations of God, finds its way back home, is literally the risen word, goes back home to the Keter, or perhaps to Dat, which is not included in the system. Well, just as the Catholics were going through this problematic time where they were wanting to stress that the Protestants were wrong about wanting to not include the Apocrypha, and so, and many other things, right, about like having common people be able to understand the Bible and not have it read to you in Latin, and so all of that was going on. Same thing with something else was going on in the Judaic tradition, and along came a rabbi named Luria. So this is known as the Lurian tradition, where he changes everything. Now, he has to be very, very careful about how he does it, but, and no doubt it was controversial at the time, just as much as the Protestant Revolution was becoming for the Catholics. Very interesting. This was at the same time as when it was happening in the Catholic world, when John Dee was a young man. And Luria said, no, there are, the Keter is really the overarching, yes, the Godhead, but one must include its companion. It's hard to stress these things in terms that are really meaningful, but Dat is the embodiment of all, everything, and he said it has to be included. And so you, and he said you have these three axes, a left axis, a middle axis, and a right axis, which kind of looked to me as being hinting at the Trinity. And I asked my good friend Moshe van der Broek, who is teaching me a lot about Kabbalah and Gematria, thank God, or thank Yahweh. It's just I don't have time to go down that rabbit hole. And I always knew eventually if I had to learn it, the divine would give me friends who would be able to teach me selflessly so that I wouldn't have to spend another lifetime going down there and trying to understand it myself. So I don't claim to understand it myself, but Moshe has been tremendously helpful, and I want to offer him deep respect for his deep wisdom and knowledge. So I simply asked him that. I said, am I right in my intuition about this, that really this looks suspiciously like the Trinity? And isn't that anathema to the Jews? I mean, the idea of, one God. You can't have a Trinity. And he confirmed that, yes, that is right, that he was trying to reveal the deeper truth. The deeper truth. Of course, it's still a monotheism, but it's this inconceivable and irreconcilable idea of Trinity, three in one, one in three. And so taking that, I realized, well, it's very, very interesting, because I'm looking at Sonnet 54, and I had Psalm 54, 46 rather, and then got to look at Psalm 54. So here's the 46, there's the 54. And you notice that there are six words, God, in Psalm 46, aside from the one at the top, which is the key one, that's the Keter, the crown. In Psalm 54, there are four words, God. And note interestingly also, this is GS, right? Guglielmus Shakespeare. Guglielmus, Latin for William Shakespeare. Very clever. But it looks suspiciously as though it's mimicking this system, doesn't it? If that's the Keter that has to really be the whole thing along with Dart, you then have there are six gods there and there are four here, and it duplicates that system in a way, if that's what they're doing. Also of interest is that the words Lord here and here and here are capitalized, where God isn't even God is not capitalized, but the word Lord is. And then over on this side, in the other psalm, one Lord is capitalized. Again, you've got the three in one and the one in three. It seems to be hinting at this irreconcilable schism between the two problematic sides. Is there a unity to be seen through this? It is very interesting because they are translating from the original Hebrew and then in the Greek, and there is another Lord in there. There's Lord here, but it's not capitalized. That's a giveaway. It's telling you, we're telling you something with these capitalized Lords. We should have and could have capitalized that other one, but we want to get the idea across of three in one and one in three. So how interesting. So putting them together. Now, this is going to take a little bit of math, so don't nod off. I'll go gently with you. The Psalm 46 and Psalm 54, there in black are the number of characters in each one. There in green are the number of characters in each of the selahs. There's three selahs in 46 and only one in 54. There are crosses, just like there were in Psalm 46. Remember I told you, three crosses placed there. They're like asterisks. So they're not necessarily really supposed to be part of the actual wording. They're not part of the wording. Are they supposed to be counted, though? I don't know. There's only one in Psalm 54. And then in blue are the various totals. If they're trying to get across different messages about the mathematics of this, you'll just see how deep this is. And I will be brief. I won't go into the depth of it entirely, but to say I'm looking for a grid, because neither one of them is a grid. Neither one of them is a perfect square or rectangular grid. There are no formations that will make a grid, and a grid has to have or be almost square in shape in order to be able to give you the various messages vertically and horizontally, doesn't it? So you look at then, you're going to look at, and this is part of a system that I'm teaching so that you can all understand how to do this. And when I release the course on Resonance Academy, it will be teaching this. You know, it's simple once you know the system. You put, if we count all the selahs and all the crosses and all the characters, it's 1322. Well, you just look up in a factorization calculator, which deals with prime numbers, what are the factors? And there are only 2 and 661. There are no other combinations that you can form other than the number 1322 itself and 1. So that doesn't make a grid. It would be 2 wide and 661 deep. It's not a grid. It doesn't work. So you're obviously not supposed to include all cellars and all crosses. How about all cellars and no crosses? Nope. Doesn't work. 2 by 659. How about no cellars and no crosses? Nope. Doesn't work. How about no cellars and all crosses? It's 22 by 59. It's getting closer, but it's still about a third the length of the width as it is length. It's not a good grid. Cellars and crosses of 46, but none of 54. Doesn't work. Cellars and crosses of 54, but none of 46. Doesn't work. That's a prime number itself, 1301. And eventually, you end up looking at all these possibilities, and there's only one possibility that gives you a grid, and that's to take all the cellars of 46 and none in 54. And, you know, I mean, I stress that just so that if anybody wanted to go into this deeply and say, why did you include the cellars of 46 but not 54? It's not just a random thing for me to say, this is what gave me the grid. There is no other grid. It's one way of verifying that this is intentional. It's to say they thought this through. They looked at it and said, well, that's the one that gives you a grid. That's the one we're going to use. And it turns out that number then of characters is 1312, which is a very significant number because, first of all, it's used in Shakespeare-related codes over and over again to symbolize the 32nd degree of Freemasonry, which you know from other presentations is the master of the royal secret. Ah, we've met that many times before. But get this, 1312 is the year the Knights Templar were finally suppressed under the papal bull of Pope Clement V. That's the year. That's it. They're over. And the Knights Templar are a key part of this. So whoever did this, Dee and Bacon and De Vere, honoring the Knights Templar in the grid, honoring the Solomon Temple, Knights Templar connection, you know, honoring the 32nd degree of Rosicrucianism and Freemasonry, all this tied together with the year that the Knights Templar were finally suppressed. 2 years previously, which doesn't give us a good grid, 1310, 54 Templars were found guilty of heresy and burned at the stake. 54. That's where the 54 comes in again. Psalm 46 and Psalm 54. So 1312 is telling you that this is the only grid that you can have, and the 54 is telling you, yes, it's about the Templars. And yes, it's about Solomon's Temple. Yes. So we have an absolutely clear connection between the 54 burned Templars and the combined 1312 characters, the only possible grid that works, that defines the final suppression of the Templar order. So now we know we've got a grid, but I'm just going to want to look at one other tiny thing. Imagine the working on this and saying, well, you might think that the mathematics is too much. It's fine. I just love the poetry and, oh, look at that. There's the crosses and it's giving us something poetic about everything. Solomon's Temple and the Ark and Ethiopia and all of that brilliance. But at the same time, is there mathematics that's perfect within it? There has to be. You understand? There has to be. Because the universe is divinely mathematically balanced. Sri Yukteswar, Yogananda's guru, says, less for want of a pin, the entire universe collapse. He was really saying poetically what is happening mathematically. Less for want of utter precise mathematics in everything, in the electrons and the protons and the right, everything. The teeny, teeny, teeny. Hi, Nassim. You'll be meeting Nassim soon. He's going to be on one of these podcasts. It has to be perfect, doesn't it? It cannot be any other way. It is divine. And there can't be anything out of balance. And so the mathematics has to be perfect too. And so these beings are telling you that by utterly finding the numbers that produce not just this, these beautiful grids and the message, but there's mathematics in it as well. So you take that 453 over 869, square it, right, because we're dealing with square grids, etc., etc. What does that make? It makes this, which happens to be Euler's number, E. Yeah, you shift the decimal one place, E over 10, to 99.97% accuracy. Euler is 2.718. But if you put it the other way, it's 1.9183, which happens to be something called the arithmetic geometric mean. And I won't go into the details of it because, frankly, I don't even understand it fully, but I looked it up. It turns out to be something to do with the fastest way that you can possibly calculate, one of the fastest ways that you can possibly calculate pi. Of course, there are other people in the particular group that I work with who believe we've got a faster way now. But nevertheless, pi. It's what? It, oh, yeah, it's the number that defines the arithmetic geometric mean of 1 and pi to 99.98% accuracy. In other words, if you shift one of these letters, just 1, it's not going to work. It goes further and further away, either one of them. Now you take the Psalm numbers, 54 over 46 cubed, that's 1.6177. That's 1.618. That is phi. That's the golden ratio. What? Oh, well, yeah. Why not? Why not be perfect in every possible way you can conceive? 99.98% accurate. Oh, turn them the other way around and make that cubed. Oh, that just happens to be, of course, little phi. Well, that's kind of obvious because that's what happens with phi. But again, it's it's been worked out to make this precision on so many levels on the math, as well as the number of Templars burnt. So that leads you down a rabbit hole that you might get a little queasy about. So let's not think too much about that. Did there have to be 54 burned? I don't know. I just don't know. Comes to that age-old question. Is there even free will? I'm not going to go there. Just showing you the math is perfect. Take the 46 psalm and the 453 of the 54 psalm, and that in itself gives you pi squared, and you just give up. You go, okay, I give up. All right, I don't know who did this, but they are certainly above my pay grade. So you've got, that's the mathematics side of it. Now let's go see what they're actually showing us by putting this, which is not a grid, and this, which is not a grid, but put together, they make a perfect grid. So 46 is pink, 54 psalm is blue. And it's a 32 grid, which I reminded you is master of the royal secret, the 32nd degree, which comes about by taking the triple tau, the I am that I am, the secret symbolism for let me try to say this correctly. I asked Moshe about it. How did I do? Moshe, let me know. Apparently I've been saying it too English all these years. It's got a real guttural sound to it. And that means I am that I am. That's the message delivered by God to Moses on Mount Sinai. I am that I am. But you connect it to that symbol that turns into a TH, right, on the gravestone and the monument and all the secret nudge, nudge, wink, wink messages between the Rosicrucians and the Templars. And it means Templum Hierosolyma, Temple of Jerusalem, Solomon's Temple. You couldn't write this. Well, I suppose you could if you were divine. Oh, I suppose he, she did. Now, that's the symbolism for it. But then you add the fourth tau, the fourth cross, that gives you master of the royal secret. Okay, 32nd degree. So what do we have here? We've got to go to the center, right? You always go to the center to find out what's the most important thing. He's always going to place it right in the center. Imagine it working this way. Like, oh, I'm going to take two psalms that have already been written in Hebrew and Greek, and I'm going to translate them, and I'm going to make them shift some words around so that I get a message across. Right in the dead center, as close to the possible to the dead center as you can get, is an I. A capital I. I. The I am that I am. That just happens to be an anagram of Sephirot. Oh, okay. Well, perfectly balanced underneath it is I am God, colon. And above it, it comes from come, behold the works of, but in the way it's placed, it's an anagram of the Word. I am God, the Word. Well, of course, that's precisely it, isn't it? That's I am God, the Word. The Om. In the beginning was the Word. And then you fill in the block around that whole I, and you've got Bereth, Sephiroth, Bereth, the Word. I am God. Well, that's exactly right. The Sephiroth conveys, Bereth carries the Word of God. Perfect. What is S-E? S-E is a little Latin word that simply means himself. Shakespeare uses it in a couple of places where he says, I am ipse, ipse. I am the writer himself, se. I am God himself, herself, itself. Sephiroth beareth the Word, I am God. Well, that's pretty conclusive. It's absolutely perfectly centered. And the right above it is perfectly centered, the Lord. And right below it is not perfectly centered, the Lord. That's where it is. Now, wrap your head around it. Obviously, anyone that's gone this far to put perfection into this could very easily have slid over the Lord by adding a comma somewhere to make it nudge up into the right place, right? So again, this is significant because you think it through. It could be over there, but there must be some other meaning to it being shifted across like that. And right in the center under the letters that give you Bereth, the Word, the spear. So that's the part that got changed, isn't it? From weapon to spear to give you the clue in the first place that the 46th word from the end was spear. Oh, the spear. Yes. Now, I always look for a triple tau in the grids. That's one of the first things you look for. Is there a triple tau? Because it's not always that it happens, even in a large grid like this. Well, there's only one triple tau in here, and it's right there. But it's more than a triple tau. It's a false tau as well. And it happens to be, right? So it's confirming, yeah, you're right. This is about the fourth tau, the master of the royal secret. And I'm pointing to something with it. Cutteth the spear. Now, you'll know from past work, John Dee's gravestone, Shakespeare's gravestone, John Dee did it. Look at that. D, double O, D, double O, seven, in the shape of a seven. So clever, so funny, so brilliant, such a laugh. They're having fun with these things as well as everything else. 007 did this. Also wrapped around the bottom of it, I don't show it in this presentation though, is around, on the left, B-A-C-O-N, by Bacon. So it's, I didn't know this years ago because I was ignoring Bacon for so long. Now, thank goodness, I've got my good friend Peter Dawkins who's set me straight. And I know that Bacon is a huge part of this whole thing. We disagree on slight little details where I still believe that De Vere's the, I don't care. I don't care. I'm interested in the truth. De Vere is absolutely central to this. Bacon is central to it. There are so many codes for both of them. Dee is central to it. These are the guys that are doing it. They're in the Rosicrucians. Dee is known to be the head of the Rosicrucians. Bacon's known to be taking the mantle from him once Dee passes in 1609. He's the next Grand Master of the Rosicrucians. Shakespeare writes in Hamlet, right? Rosencrantz and Guildenstern are in the play. Sound like Rosencreutz and the Knights of the Golden Stone? Yes, it does. The Rosicrucian Manifesto of Rosencreutz and the Knights of the Golden Stone. It's they're just playing with us. Anyway, in that grid, he's got the word spear, with a D under it, speared in the side. That is a pictogram of the altar in Holy Trinity Church, Stratford. Speared, because right there in the side is where I saw the little star that shouldn't be there, the cross, the fourth cross, the fourth tau cross on the side. It's not a tau cross, actually. It's a perfect Templar cross, actually. Because there's three on top where there should be five, but two have been hacked off, and then so they've put a fourth one on the side there, which is telling you there, inside the altar is where it is. What's there? Oh, right, the triple tau and the triple S. The triple tau is the I am that I am. The triple S is the stiletto side solo, God in creation and God out of creation, the ark and the Holy of Holies is what they mean. It's right there. It's what's known as a pictogram. It's not just clever being clever with the positioning of the letters. It's a picture. He's drawn a picture of the altar. So I thought, has he drawn a picture here too? Is that what's going on here? Because if so, I'm going to wrap this box around here and find out what's in there. Because I know how he works. I can't wait to see what's in there. All right, but before I show you what's in there, because that's the coup de grace of this whole thing, I'm going to show you something else. When you slide the Sephiroth over, because it's basically telling you to, this is it, the Sephiroth. What if you just slide it over there into position over precisely where all those connections have been made? The Lord. All right, so you're going to see it hovers over certain letters. There's a TH. Oh, that's the TH. That's the symbolism. I am that I am. You know, B. Oh, the verb to be. I am that I am. To be. Or not to be. PT, that's a little harder, but that is the chi rho. The P, he uses this often, as P is really the Greek letter rho, which is an R, and the T is the cross, and when he puts them together, D I'm talking about, it gives you the symbolism for the chi rho, which means alpha omega. I am the beginning and the end. It's a symbolism of the Christ, chi rho, which just happens to be the word Cairo, by the way, so wrap your head around that one. And the Great Pyramid, right? Okay, we got a Cairo there, the Alpha and the Omega. What else have we got? Down here, we've got a TH. Oh, another TH, I am that I am. Up here, we've got D and R, doctor. And down here, we've got I and colon, his favorite things. I is the J for John, Dr. John D. He's signing it. Up at the top here, you've got, oh, down at the bottom, I did it in the other order, EO. That's why the Lord is shifted over in this one, because then the center letters are E and O. That's Edward Oxenford, Lord Edward Oxenford. The center lines up here are L and B, Lord Bacon. They're all signing it. Clever. And H, R, H, down the middle. We all know what that stands for. Her Royal Highness. So Master of the Royal Secret, here's Her Royal Highness in between Lord Bacon and Lord Edward Oxenford. Note that John Dee is not in line with her because he's not a son of the Queen, but it has been extremely well speculated by many, many nutcase researchers like myself and others who disagree with the common story, that the Queen had a few dalliances. It's good to be the Queen. Obviously, she'd have to hide these children, and she ends up, it's pretty well known that Lord Bacon was probably her child because of the way he was treated. It's pretty well suspected, though it's hard to wrap your head around it, that De Vere was her child, because that would have been her first one when she was 14. But there's evidence that she had a child when she was 14, when she was raped by Thomas Seymour and his wife. Those Tudors, honestly, you got to hand it to them. What a laugh. And so, was he the son of the Queen? Well, that's hard to prove until you find it in about 7 different grids, and then it's a different story. So right there, literally right down the center of this thing is Lord Bacon, HRH for Her Royal Highness. Note the word she is in there as well, she, but then is it saying His Royal Highness as well? They are children of the Queen. I don't know yet. I intend to show you more. So Lord Bacon, that's one of the lords in that's been checked off. Lord Edward Oxenford, that's the other one. Now notice, both of those say the same thing. They are saying the Lord of Hosts is with us, the God of Jacob. Down at the bottom, the Lord of Hosts is with us, the God of Jacob. They say exactly the same thing for both of those two lords that have been capitalized. What about this other lord here? Well, okay, if that's Lord Bacon and that's Lord Edward Oxenford, who is this? The Lord, and there's a cross there, and it's Lord Essex with a TT, which the TT is the symbol for telling you this is a code, right? that's how you solve the code. And down here, right under it, continuing down, Bide. Now I've got to I've got to now honor Peter Dawkins again, who is going to be on again. Part two of Peter Dawkins' interview is going to be 4 weeks from today. He's very graciously decided that he can fit in the time to come back, and I'm so thrilled about it. And I asked him about this because I have been of the opinion that the Essex Rebellion was not what history says it was, and not without going into the whole thing. Essex and Rosalie, Henry Rosalie, the other suspected son of now Edward de Vere and the Queen. So let's put that one on hold for a moment. They're involved in something called the Essex Rebellion. And I thought that they were just going to break into the Queen's residence to simply force her. She's going senile, she's close to the end of her life. And just to tell her, choose one. Choose the right heir to the throne, because you've got a couple standing right before you. I thought that was what was going on. And there are other parts of it that really do confirm that as far as Rosalie is concerned. But Essex, it turns out, Peter gave me some information that Bacon had written about Essex, and it's absolutely convincing. And so all of a sudden this made sense. There's the word lied. Essex lied. He really was rebelling, and he really was trying to perform a coup. And so it's here, it's written. And yet they're still honoring him, because he is a child of the Queen, at least according to this interpretation. Now, so look at this. You've got, how can I confirm to you that there's something going on that can confirm it even deeper than just this idea that, oh, well, Alan, you found a cross and it happens to say lied. And look at this, be removed. I'm just showing you where they occur in the grid. Be carried. Be troubled. Be moved. Be still. Be exalted. Now look at this be. I will be, buzz, buzz, buzz. I will be, has a double E, which has the effect of pushing the grid over so that the word exalted shifts over one more space, so you get the X of Essex. Perfect, brilliant. They had to spell B wrong in order to get it to work. But it goes even deeper than that. There's the B exalted, you see. That's the only way you can get this X. Be still and know that I am God. Look how they spell still. They spell it wrong. Now, granted, there's a comma after it. And this is one of the most important phrases in the Bible, at least as far as people that I know who know a lot about this. Yogananda used to quote it a lot, and Sri Dayamata, his successor, used to say it a lot in convocations. Think of it, be still and know that I am God. It is telling you to be still. Meditate. Go in. Be still and know that I am God. It's not just the Lord God saying to David, the baffled king composing Hallelujah, be still and know that I am God. I am God, but you're just David. It's not that. It's you will know who you are when you be still. Be still, my beating heart. Meditation techniques allow you to do that. Slow the pulse, slow the heart. Advanced yogis can just stop their heart. Right? Just utter stillness so that the bliss can pour through. Be still, but you can't say, be still and know that I am God. It doesn't make any sense. You've got to say, be still and know that I am God. Therefore, there has to be a comma there. So if the comma is there, that's not going to give you, if you spell still correctly, it's going to shift I am God over, and then it's not going to be central to the whole structure, is it? And then the B is not, you know, that's all going to, yeah, then you could spell B correctly, but you see, how you've got to choose one or the other. And so they end up saying, well, you've got to have the comma or else you don't get the poetic sense of it. Just doesn't make sense to say, be still and know that I am God. No, be still and know that I am God. Therefore, it has to be spelt wrong. Oh, well, and then you got exalted. So when you see something like that, it's another verification. Right? It's another clear verification. They're saying, we spelt it wrong on purpose, and we spelt B wrong on purpose, all to get the I am God to line up. And even though you see all this slam dunk evidence of the beauty of this, some naysayers might say, oh, come on, Alan. You know, surely they spell that way occasionally, and so you're just making something out of nothing. Here's my copy of a facsimile of the King James Bible. And in fact, if I scoot over a couple of pages, you get to see, look at that. There's the engraving that we've been decoding. But here, I've gone through every single place where the word still is in the King James Bible. Because, of course, I have no life. And so I've got time to do such a thing for you. So you don't have to. You're welcome. What does this mean? Every time, I'm going to show you. Of course, you can look at it online. You can do a search and say, "Find still." All right. But I was interested in which have the same meaning as "be still," and so there are 68 instances of the word "still" in the King James Bible. You can find them online. But then I went and checked specifically to make sure that was not, you know, I wasn't just taking their word for it. I checked in the Bible itself. So phrases such as "be still," "keep still," "sit still," "stood still," etc. Only one is spelled "still," S-T-I-L, and that's Psalm 46. Only one. All the others are spelled correctly. And there they are. Be still. Be a still. Be not still. Are you still? Was still. Have been still. Remain still. Held still. Hold them still. Keep still. Sit still. Sat still. Stood still. Stand thou still. 12 times, 14 times, 2 times, etc., etc. Okay, so it's beyond question. It's real. I've added a few here just so that you can actually see it, and you might want to pause the video to look at the fact that, but they all spell it correctly. The only time that in that context of "be still" it is spelled that way is there. Therefore, ipso facto, yes, it's deliberate, as is "be." And that is why you end up with that whole thing being, look, I mean, that you've now got confirmation. You've got a Lord Bacon, you've got a Lord Edward Oxenford, and you've got a Lord Essex, who all have been suspected of being sons of the Queen, hidden sons. Right? Shifted off into different families. Changeling child. Midsummer Night's Dream, remember? I beg the changeling child to be my henchman. Okay, so that's this one. That's where that one occurs. And look what it says there. At that place it says, "Lord, what desolations he hath made." Wow. That's the Lord that references in this code Essex, and "what desolations he hath made" is true. He tried to rebel against the Queen. And that's why you end up with an extra selah at the end, which means pause to think about what you've said. But I mean, there's no selah in the original, in the Greek 45, Psalm 45, which was then changed to Psalm 46. I've since found out that it was originally Psalm 46 back in the Hebrew. So it's very interesting. It was from 46 to 45 to back to 46. Selah. And here's where you get selah. That's where it ends up giving you that. So let me just go back quickly. You see? Even that, you could not, it wouldn't work. You wouldn't have the E of lied, and you wouldn't have the D of lied, which is in the next psalm, unless you had the Selah there. It's all perfect. In fact, it's more perfect. There's a Lord here in this one. Why is that Lord capitalized? Well, it doesn't work unless you revolve it. M-O-A-I, to sway my life. If this fall into thy hand, revolve. If you revolve them around, then the O Lord is on its own like that, and you can find out what is being said there. And I'm going to save that for the next podcast, because it's a doozy. So just to wrap up here, down at the bottom here, look at that. Perfectly balanced again. The word risen. How perfect. Of course, the word risen. I am the risen word of God. And right above it is this cross, which is where Malkuth on the Sephiroth lands. which is a TH vertically, a TH horizontally, a Y, which is a TH, if you remember. Y is the printer's thorn, which means TH. So you've got TH, 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 I. I am, that I am, the one in three, the three in one. This is about as perfect as you can get. I defy anybody to just say, oh, no, 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 that's just another coinkydink. No, it cannot be. Now, let me take you to the final conclusion of this, because if you're not impressed so far, you must not have a beating heart. That's all I can say. What's wrong with you? Look at this. Because this, I still look at this and I've been, you know, losing sleep over this, and it still astounds me to look at this. I said before, is John D making a pictogram just like he did in the grave? I've just drawn an outer segment for it, a box, just like he does in the gravestone. What is that box there? Why have I drawn a box there? Because on the left-hand side, with a little nudge, a little handle on the side there, are the words alter and TT, which is the way you solve it. But crossing the alter perfectly is a triple tau. Oh, it's the triple tau. It's the I, of course, it's the I am that I am, the holy of holies, altar stone, which I have already radar scanned and did not go to prison for. Yay. And so that's the alter. On the other side, then, it's got to be perfectly balanced, hasn't it? What's on the other side? Well, it's the arc. No prizes for guessing that. And these two letters that are left over, I and E, which when you then put all the extraneous letters over, you have John D's favorite thing again. T-E-T, I am the et, the beginning and the end, and the end and the beginning. Balanced, put together. Who is? I is. I am the beginning and the end and the end and the beginning. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the Aleph Tav, the Ark, the Altar. Okay, it's beginning to look like this is a... Looks a bit like an ark, doesn't it? Except the those poles should be a lot longer. No. Imagine like trying this out and going, I wonder if they've... those are the poles, right? Yeah, those are the poles. Look what it says. Take the both end of. Take the both end of. Oh, of course. Take the both end of the ark. That's a poetic way of saying lift it up, isn't it? Take both ends. That's how you carry it through the desert. That's how they carried it through the desert on the 40 years journey, etc., etc., etc. But it's not just that, is it? That would be too simple. But it's got the poetry of it. Take the both end of. But what is it really saying? Of the I am that I am on both ends, the I et. I take the both ends of, take God into your heart at both ends. This is, they're telling you, this is how you should live. Take the Alpha and the Omega into your life, into your heart. Take both end. That's the way to live. Take the both end of the arc, the two letters that are left over on each side are he and he. I'll show you that again. Look at them in red. He and he. There's the two letters that are left in the handles. That's the word of God, the name of God, isn't it? Yod he, vav he. Two he's. The two letters that are the same words in the tetragrammaton name of God, which is four letters, but is really three. Yod and he and vav. The three in one. The one in three. And there are two of them in the name. And they're there. The altar. That's triple tau and the triple S. The Holy of Holies and the Ark. The Ark is inside the Holy of Holies. The altar is the Holy of Holies. It's named the Holy of Holies. It's the Devere. It's Devere's name, Edward Devere's name. Veer comes in with the name Veer, which is Latin for truth, but it's also Devere, the Hebrew word for the word. The original vibration of God, the Om. Stunning. Absolutely perfect. You've got, and then I think, all right, that's amazing. I wonder if the four quadrants in the middle, like the four quadrants of the Enochian tables, also say something in the white areas there. And they do. Half risen here. Now, which is exactly it, isn't it? That's you, that's resurrection. You've come home. Done the whole journey, done the 10 emanations. You've found your way back to Malkuth. You've done it in a 3-in-1. You're back. And it's applying to us, isn't it? It's not just to Christ, it's the Christ. The Christ in all of us, for we all are the Christ. Take the both end of this way you can think of the divine, and you will have here risen now. That will take you home. Inconceivable. Inconceivable that that could be done in such a way. That's 87 characters, all absolutely perfectly placed. Who can do such a thing? Only beings who are in divine consciousness. So, to finish, I just don't really know even what more is there to say, except you see the perfection on so many levels. It's obviously not just intended, it has been treated as a magnum opus, a sacred work. I will finish it off at the next podcast. I have a little surprise, because coming on is a friend of mine who you saw on podcast one, which featured, of course, Michael Delahoyd and Michael Dunn. Michael Dunn is going to be in town, and he's going to pop in and say hello. So that's nice, in 2 weeks' time. And then 2 weeks after that, Peter Dawkins, my dear friend, will be doing part two of his wildly popular visit to the Bardcast. I'm so thrilled to have him back, and he's going to be shedding more light on what we talked about the first time, only I didn't really give him enough time to talk about it then, because I was so excited to show a certain aspect and then say, here, now hold forth. So he's going to hold forth on it next time, and that will be something. Really, there's no other way to sum this up than to hand it back to the great, great, great poet I introduced you to at the beginning. Hopefully you already know of him. For those of you who don't know of him, check him out. He's the greatest. So remember, that's how the light gets in.